farming meeting. We're going to have a presentation by Lisa on rapid ochia death and that whole situation going on. Then we'll have time to enjoy potluck food. Sorry, I didn't make potluck food this month, but I did show up. Thank you all for bringing food. And then after that, then we'll have time to go over kind of talking about Korea and that stuff. So I'm going to get things set up here, but in the meantime, I wanted to kind of pass these flyers around. Master Cho is coming to the island, and he's going to be visiting here. And he's going to be giving a workshop on January 13th, 14th, and 15th. It's going to be at the UH Ag Farm. And then Master Cho's son will be coming as well, and he'll be coming here a week after that, and he'll be giving a seminar at the Civic Auditorium. So we got the Civic because it's like a larger venue. We're trying to get a large enough venue for both, but it's kind of last minute for all this. So, but we'll be able to seat about 600 people for Young Son's lecture, and that'll include a certification in ultra low cost agriculture. So it's kind of nice to get certified in this because these methods, he has a thing that it's a natural bug solution, which is formerly known as pesticide, but we kind of call it that because it's a reserved word. So it's kind of like Prince, you know, artist formerly known as pesticide. And then he'll be doing a practical demo at the UH Ag Farm where you actually go through this method where you mix sulfur and potassium hydroxide and a few other things together to make this pesticide. I've been using it as an edible thing to cure teeth bacteria. I've still been working on this problem for a long time, but this is like immediate, awesome, kills bad bacteria and bad fungus. So that's going to be cool, but to get to the third day, you kind of have to buy this package deal because, again, we only have seating for 240 people at the UH Ag Farm. But we're going to have 600 for the Civic. So if you're interested in the third day, you have to buy the package deal, which includes Master Cho's visit. And, but Young Son will be here on the 26th, 27th, and 28th. And he'll be presenting at the Civic as well as the UH Ag Farm. So what I'm going to do is take a little time to talk story and get to meet and greet each other when we get things set up, we get the screen set up, we'll have a presentation, and then move forward from there. So thank you all for coming, thanks for everyone for like last minute being able to change the venue too, because Omohana just, even after that renovation, I just spent a couple years fixing it, and now it's condemned again because they botched the contract and water leaked, and it's actually black mold inside the walls, which we all know as natural farmers, we could just spray LAB and fix it, but you know, they're going to spend a couple million dollars to do something else. So again, that's why it pays to be a natural farmer, because quick, easy, good solutions for all the problems that we presently have. But yeah, take this time to meet, greet each other, because we gotta set this stuff up. So we're gonna start the meeting, as I said, with the presentation on the rapid ochia death. And Lisa Keith is here from PMARC, I believe. Yeah, with PMARC. And so Dana Kiyami reached out to her to kind of talk about this critical issue facing us. And she made this connection to have an expert come and just update us on what's all going on. So please welcome Lisa. And then you can use the arrow to go forward.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity to give you an update. Sorry.
Lights.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I got
them. To update you on a very devastating new disease, and actually, so yes, Dana and I have connected, and the purpose is actually to do some work together with the natural farming community. So I'm going to give you an update about the disease, the type of work we do in my laboratory, kind of where this is heading. I'll try to be brief. I have a lot of pictures, and it's a lot of scientific stuff, but really in a friendly way. So, and please stop me. If you have questions along the way, I'd be happy to answer them, or you can wait till the end and hopefully have a better discussion. But I am Lisa Heath, Dr. Flynn Hughes, and Dr. Jamie Friday, and I all collaborate on this project, Rapid Okita. Okay. So it's not just us, we actually have a huge team. Yeah, that would help you. No, you can read it off my and you'll see a lot of Scooby-Doo references, because that's kind of how I see my laboratory, Mystery Incorporated. But a big shout out actually to Lionel Wade and Lane, who are in my laboratory and who do lots and lots of work. Okay. So, I'm sure you're probably maybe already familiar. I'm sorry, I'm going to walk around a little. Ohia is the dominant tree, 8% in the native forest, a primary succession and old growth species. It forms almost pure stands and, but it's super important for our watershed, for the wildlife, cultural purposes. I mean, the list is extensive. Maybe I should try this one. The map of the state of Hawaii, indicating how much of the native forest and where you can find all the ohia. So the big island, the dry, mesic, wet, mixed wet, mesic areas, you can actually see 252,000 hectares, a hectare almost 2.5 acres, gives you an idea of really what's at stake here. So there's been a noticeable increase in ohia mortality in the Puna district, particularly on Hawaii Island over the last 5 years. And again, I'll just say one more time, I apologize, I see they got a little jumbled somewhere. But the picture you're looking at with this red dot actually shows 2008 and then what has gone on in 2012 with the number of trees dying in that area. Okay. So the project kind of got started, forestry, federal forestry, university, really looking at a number of different aspects, but then I became involved with the project pretty much the first part of last year to help unravel the mystery of rapid ohia death. Okay. So before I get started really deep into the science, I'm a plant pathologist, meaning I study plant diseases. And really what we do is we try to figure out what is it, how bad is it, and how can we manage and control it. Okay? It's really important to know what is normal if you're looking for something that's not normal. And then a lot of times, the organisms, when it comes to pathogens, they can be native problems, which sometimes aren't as bad. Okay, so if they're kind of co-evolving with their host, they're not as detrimental as maybe something that's exotic or introduced, an invasive species comes in and actually wreaks havoc. And when it comes to plant pathology, it's all about the disease triangle. Without the host, the pathogen, and a favorable environment, you won't actually get disease, okay? So three critical components, but you can see there's lots of areas when it comes to the environment. The susceptible host, pathogens can be a number of things. So if there's any way to minimize or actually eliminate a portion of the triangle, you can manage or virtually eliminate disease. Okay. So we tend to study the disease cycle, and that means looking for signs of the disease and symptoms of the disease. So signs are actually the physical manifestation of the organism, okay? So that can be that discoloration in the wood, okay? That's actually rapid ohia death. It can be an odor, like this fruity banana smell, okay? Because of the fungus that grows and produces that particular odor. we go looking for symptoms, which is how the host responds to pathogen attack. Okay? In this case, it was rapid browning of leaves, resulting in complete foliar death. The leaves actually remain attached, okay? So it's almost like a really rapid drought occurred, brown leaves attached to the trees. Many, many, many times, landowners are looking out their backyard and saying, it looks like the tree was healthy, and in 2 weeks it's dead. And we've heard that time and time again. Ultimately resulting, unfortunately, in dead trees. Okay. So the first thing we started doing was field sampling, and it's all about finding the right samples. So we would actually fell the entire tree with the typical symptoms. Okay, so by now it's those typical symptoms associated. And once we started sampling, you can see that we would run into the vascular discoloration. Okay, so producing cookies, that was a new term for me, right, as a forestry person. So actually sandwich cookies of the trunk area or branches. Sometimes the discoloration was just on the edge and it was really narrow. And sometimes it actually went and it looked like this starburst pattern, okay? A little easier sometimes to see if you do kind of a slash on the trunk. You can see the lateral discoloration. Okay, so studying disease, basically with samples, we started to do these tree autopsies. And scientists take a lot of data, take a lot of notes. And so we start documenting, where do we see symptoms? Where do we see that discoloration? Did we notice that through the smell? What parts were it associated with? How far did this extend? Things like that. Okay? You bring those samples back to the laboratory. Now you have to figure out, well, is it a pathogen causing the problem? And there's just traditional methods to be able to isolate and purify the fungus, in this case, onto a plate to get a pure culture. Okay, that's kind of the first stage. That's the key stage. And so, once again, that is discoloration caused by the organism, okay, in the wood. This is when you take this discolored wood and actually put it into an environment of high humidity, or the fungus starts to grow, it starts to produce these structures, actually called parathecia. There are these fruiting bodies. At the end, it starts to produce a lot of spores, or what starts to kind of get around. And it doesn't matter what you do, ultimately, it's the pure culture on a plate that you're after, okay? So we can identify fungi a number of ways. You can have it growing on a plate, see what it looks like, the color, the shape, under the microscope, you know, the size of the spores, things like that. We also use molecular analysis. So in a tube, you can do work where you start actually identifying its DNA, and then you can put what you find into a database and see what it matches up to. Okay, so the morphological and molecular should match. And that's when we realized we were working with Ceratocystis fimbriata. Okay. So once you have a pure culture of the organism, how do you prove that's the pathogen causing the disease? Okay. So you go through and you conduct pathogenicity tests. You start with a healthy host, in this case, an Nokia seedling. You'll see the pure culture of the fungus. Okay. We use the flat graft method, where we're essentially just putting some of the pure culture of the fungus into the wound, because this organism does need some kind of entryway into the host. Wrap it up and sit and wait. Okay, so we thought it's gonna be fast, right? It's a pretty harsh organism. And in fact, it actually took a while. And looking at it, you couldn't really see anything, okay? Now remember, a lot of people were saying, oh, it looks alive and then it looks dead, yeah? It kind of takes time. And a lot of times it does. Inside, something's happening, the disease process is happening. When do you see the symptoms? And then we walked in probably about 65 days later,
and we notice the first sign of wilt. Okay, so that meant where that arrow is. This green wilt, and actually 4 days after that, that whole branch died. Okay, so it went that brown, rapid, and within a couple weeks, the rest of the shoots wilted, and again, within those 3-4 days after, it died. Ultimately, then killing the entire seed branch. Okay, so now you're seeing exactly what you're seeing in the field with that. Seems rapid. Dead leaves attached to the plant. We do that same kind of autopsy. We know where we inoculated the plant. Is the fungus moving? What is it doing? Now you take your cross section and we see that typical discoloration, internal discoloration, and we can tell how far the fungus has moved and where we can find it. And what's really challenging with this is it doesn't colonize the whole tree. Okay? It really stays somewhat localized to where it enters. Okay? The last stage is actually to end up with the pure culture that you put in the plant. And we actually use carrots as a baiting tool. Okay? This genera of fungi really like it. It inhibits a lot of other things, so it makes it much easier to collect it back. So that's a piece of wood. And you can see some of the discoloration then, the fungus is actually growing into the carrot. And you start to see those same parathesia, those fruiting structures with the spores, get them back on the plate, and now you have completed post-phosphorus, okay? It's the same fungus, okay. So that was really only the beginning. A lot has gone on since, a lot of research is taking place. Survey, we need to figure out, well, where is this organism on island, off island? I mean, extensive work has been done with that. And this is really now to show you that, really, in less than probably, we really just discovered and named the disease at the end of last year, so now, these are confirmed areas of rapid ochia death on island. It does seem to be spreading. Right now it is just on the big island. And yeah, it kind of gives you the sense of right now it's now found on Konasai, Hilo District, Puna District, it's Volcano Village, unfortunately. Okay, so a number of other things. A lot of times the spores, well, in this case, they're not just windblown, okay? Other diseases, the wind can just carry the reproductive spores of the fungus. That's not the case here. Usually they're sticky, they attach to something, they're fruity smelling, so oftentimes it has some association with an insect. We don't want to keep cutting down huge trees, and we want to make it easier to sample, easier for people to get us samples. So we really started working on these rapid field-friendly assays. So not only could we look at wood, we could look at the soil, we could look at insect frass. We're doing testing. Okay, so yes, there are records of Ceratocystis dysfimbriata on Hawai'i Island. It does cause black rot of sweet potato. That is not the same thing, okay? We could have a discussion all day on the genetics of this organism. Researchers have made it somewhat complicated, okay? But that is not the same C. fimbriata causing disease in Ochia, okay? We're trying to do a lot of the genetics work, the biology, so the more you know about the organism, which I'm sure, right, you understand that, the more you understand the biology, now you can try to manage it. Now you can try to do different strategies to control it. Okay, so just because to me they're cool pictures to show off. What the organism looks like under the microscope, again, kind of a close up of what some of these structures are. We do work with different media components. How does that affect growth? Does it grow faster, slower? What temperature is best? What temperature doesn't it really grow? What type of spores are produced? So this organism produces 3 to 4 spore types, and one is actually very resistant. It's very resistant to drought, it's very resistant to colder temperatures, warmer temperatures. So they just hang out, and when the conditions are right, they can start causing disease again. Okay. You learn more biology, now some of the management techniques. As far as we know, a certain temperature will kill it if we hit it hot enough. Then you can start working with plant material, drenches or water baths. It's, you have to find the right balance. Don't kill the plant, but kill the fungus. We start to look at chemicals and things. I know it's a bad word, chemicals, but things that are used in other systems, on the mainland tree diseases, things we have in the laboratory. Very important to see, in this case, working with fungicides. There are concentrations where it looks like it doesn't cause them to grow. Okay, control on the left, the center doesn't look like it grew out, but it actually remained alive. Okay, so it's critical. We need to kill it, find the right concentration to kill it, not just kind of have it go into hibernation. Okay, then there's ways of, we're working with companies to see about drenching, about injecting, which is really, again, why I'm here, to learn as much as I can about what you guys do. So I guess some important closing information. Yeah. How does the pathogen move? Okay, wood, firewood, they'll move it, okay? From infected areas to other areas. That's probably one of the key ways it's going around, okay? We know we found it in soil. We know we found it in insect frass, meaning when beetles bore in and kind of the sawdust is produced, the sticky spores are attached to that. That becomes windblown, okay? So in mud, vehicles, you can see how even people hiking into infected areas and now into non-infected areas, not a good idea. Okay, so right now, key management strategies, don't move Okia wood. Okay, that's critical. There are sanitation methods that we've tested and we know kills the organisms by using things like 10% bleach, rubbing alcohol, Lysol concentrate, okay, not just any Lysol. We know Simple Green does not work. It's not effective at killing organisms. Washing, right, with soap and water. Vehicles, if you're in the forest. And so with this type of information and really the critical nature we're dealing with, and because it hasn't been found off island, HDOA has implemented a quarantine of Okia plants and plant parts. We are involved in the testing of things that want to be shipped off island. And that's kind of in a nutshell. A lot of stuff going on, but this is what I see my Scooby-Doo. So you gotta, we would have gotten away with it if it weren't for you meddling kids, right? So I appreciate the opportunity to actually kind of give the information. That's a really good place to go, www.rapidokiadeath.org, set up by the university. Everything I'm talking about, all the updates as the maps are, the distribution is corrected and enhanced, and that's a place to go. But thank you very much. I appreciate your time. I already saw a hand.
Yeah. You know, what you're saying is that to not remove Okia out of the forest is like saying you cannot make smoked beef or you cannot make emu anymore. You know, and it's kind of like what you're saying. Messing with the lifestyle of the local people and the population we're in. You know, and not only that, you know, the way I look at it, all of this is all over the island already. It's like fire ants. You know, you take fire ants out of the dump and stuff like that and say, well, you can get fire ants in your property. You already have fire ants in your property. It's all around, you know. So it's a matter of management. Think about it is, you know, I'm thinking in my head, you know, you look at, you see the spore, and it's, I don't know if it's virus, it's a parasite, you know, what is it? But you look at the things regarding the Tectocarpus ovatus, you know, that was introduced, you know, for biocontrol, for the vibe issue, the strawberry guava. You know, that's another thing, you know. A lot of stuff is being introduced and stuff like that, and it's messing up with our lifestyle here as local people. You know, now you're saying that, oh, don't take it out of forest. Most people are not going to know what's infected and what's not. And they got to make their emu, they got to make their smoked meat. So how are you going to control that?
Okay, you bring up a lot of excellent points, and especially the last thing, a lot of bad things are coming in. That's true. Knowing areas of infected wood, infected forest, and you can see it if you've been down Leilani Estate. I mean, it's pretty incredible what's going on. Those are heavily infected trees. So if that wood goes somewhere else and either beetles start boring or you're cutting, you are contributing to spreading the fungus. So yeah, it's a real, it's tough. I mean, we understand the importance of Ohia and what it means, like I say, culturally, with the watershed, with the native flora and fauna, we're seeing areas, I guess, it's comprises so much of the native forest, and right now, it's too early to tell if any trees will actually survive, okay? I can't imagine what's gonna happen if all the Ohia goes away. I mean, that's, we're early into this new disease. So hopefully you can help manage, help prevent the spread, particularly to areas that we're not seeing those symptoms yet. I mean, that's really what the message is. I understand a lot of this, the importance, and but when it's better not to take wood from Kuna District and go to areas close to pristine forest reserves that right now are not showing any symptoms. That's really the best suggestion we can give. Knowing that major tree diseases around the world, that's kind of the number one culprit. That you take firewood, you know, you're cutting down, it's a lot of inoculum, your tools are dirty, you go into a clean area, you haven't cleaned your tools, you now start cutting it. This just perpetuates the disease.
So. Have you checked for the disease over in Orchid Land, HPP,
yes.
All those places, are they also affected?
Yes.
They are?
Unfortunately, the Pune District is very heavily infested. I mean, you can kind of keep going towards the park, Fern Acres, Manlo Estates, Volcano Village. It's not in the park yet. We found it over in Halu'aloa, Kealakekua. Really, every day we get new samples, and unfortunately, we're seeing more and more. And again, it's too early to tell how bad it can get.
You know, I'm not trying to sharpshoot you or anything like that, okay? Excuse me. But, you know, and this is where you guys come in as far as higher echelon governmental agencies, you know, to educate the real estate people and the buyers that's coming in from different countries and just leveling Ohia forests and stuff like that, putting up for sale signs. You guys should use some of that money to do that. You know, educate the real estate people, and then try to, you know, preserve as much of the Ohia and the natural landscaping as possible, you see? And maybe we won't have some of that problem. Now, when you take down an acre worth of Ohia and you just bury it and stuff like that, what the hell does that do? It doesn't do anything but show waste, you know? So, why don't you use some of your money to do that, okay? And educate the real estate people. And educate the people who come here that don't cut down all the Ohia forest. Protect the forest. Protect the Ohia. Do that. Because in essence, what's happening now is that it's causing a lot of the local population from enjoying the forest because you cannot do this anymore, or you cannot cook anymore because it's infected, because you're taking it out of a place that might be infected. And it's only probabilities, you know, from what I look at. It's all speculation to me. But, you know, we still get wood from the different parts of the forest, and I've never seen that infection, you know, what you said, as far as the boar and things like that. I've never seen really a rotten, what do you call, olea tree. Did you bring a sample or anything?
No, I can go back to these real typical symptoms. So again, it's different from a rock. You don't tend to see anything on the outer trunk. This is looking at an area where you have what you're finding. Sometimes they look healthy. Sometimes the canopy looks like it's starting to change a little bit, yellow to brown, and then you'll see brown and dead. Sometimes this is looking up, part of the canopy still looks healthy, dead. Really what's happening is the organism, it's a fungus, it's getting in, it's plugging the vascular system, yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you have firewood, you should burn it, it's good, it gets rid of stuff. It's really just a recommendation of helping prevent the spread into other areas, yeah.
So it's not just a process of dieback?
No, so it's very different than what occurred in the 80s and 90s. The Ohia dieback was actually more of a cohort senescence. Lava, first thing that comes, right, the Ohia, they tend to be all the same age, and it was found that they actually all got old and started dying at the same time. This is really different. Again, we believe it's been introduced on a different host. It came in, it finds the environment, it finds another host. Right now, it's not causing disease. We can't find it. We're trying to do studies to see if it can infect other things. It seems really specific for Ohia. And really, I totally agree with you. We're trying to get the word out. Outreach, education, that's a key component. We have a working group that has like 65 people involved, from the cultural side to the government side to people groups to Facebook to farmers, really anyone and everyone that will listen. And two, to me, environmentally friendly, and that's key, and that's kind of why I was, you know, honored to be able to come and kind of share, give a research update, but then how can we attack this problem in many different ways? Okay, we started with fungicides because that's what we had, and that's what we knew helped trees all other parts of the world. But I'm here, I don't really know anything about the natural farming, and so that's why I'm here, to learn, to get a better understanding, and actually to do some scientific studies to see, can we help this in a different way? So I want to learn as much as I can tonight and answer questions, because I know there's a lot of things that, you know, float around and maybe aren't true with this as well.
So. There are Ohia in New Zealand as well. Has it happened there?
No. So as of yet, this is the only, first time. Yes. Yes.
So you've identified the pathogen,
yes,
but not the vector.
That's correct. That's where all the genetic studies we're trying to do. Yeah.
Has this particular pathogen, is it something new, or is it associated with other types of botany disasters?
Well, Ceratocystis fimbriata actually causes disease on close to 100 different types of crops around the world, mainly agricultural crops, and a lot of times plantation forestry in other parts of the world. This is rather new, actually being involved with the native forests. So good, there's a lot of information to pull from, but you still have to learn what's going on here, and it doesn't follow the typical things all the time. When you start looking at the genetic makeup of the fungus, if it's all identical, so it's like, you know, identical clones of each other, oh, I find it here, I find it here, I find it here, I compare, and they're identical, usually that's been introduced.
It's usually the native things that go through a lot of changes and evolve, and there's a lot of differences in their makeup. Yeah. So that's why we really believe it has been introduced. And again, right now, this is kind of the first part of the world that is experiencing something like this. But we're connecting with New Zealand, we're connecting with other Metrosideros, trying to figure out, where did it come from? What else can, be affected? And how can we stop this problem?
So then, is this fungus genetically identical to the other funguses, like the one that affects the apex?
Oh, no. So yeah, so researchers have complicated things sometimes. Mm-hmm. There's lots of things called Ceratocystis fimbriata. And what ended up happening is they became very host-specific. So they found something on Ceratocystis fimbriata, but they realized it only affected plane trees. Like sycamore, and so they changed the species name. And the same thing happened with oak. They found Ceratocystis fimbriata on oak, and they realized, wow, it's only affecting oak. And so that, as their studies have advanced and really looking at the genetics, so that's why we know it's not from sweet potato. It's not from, there are a couple records in Hawai'i on Syngonium, and actually on Taro, it was found on Oahu, on Taro. They're not genetically the same, and you can do experiments. It's like you can try to infect Syngonium, it doesn't cause a problem, and vice versa. So again, it seems really host-specific. I have an idea it probably will be a new species, but that's all the extensive work we've done.
Is anybody doing a seed banking project in conjunction with this?
Yes, so that will be starting, I believe, around February time. But that's some of the stuff we're looking at as well. So on a larger scale, more forestry ecology and plot dynamics and what's happening over time, forestry is really looking at and monitoring, how many trees in a given area become diseased, and over time, how many are actually dying. We're trying to collect seed, actually do studies on host resistance. I know there's very few true species. Okay, there's a lot of varieties of Ohia here, but that's somewhat we're hopeful for. Maybe not all the trees are dying because there are some differences in their genetics that allow them to survive. And then if that's the case, then you can help reforest with things like that. Yeah.
So if you feel that it's been introduced, is there a core where it's come from? Or where is it not from? Where is the base?
We suspect the Pune district, just because of the devastation there already. But again, is that because the environment is just better and it's happening faster? That's what we're trying to get a better handle on. It seems like Leilani Estates area. One critical thing that occurred was Kamehameha school lands. They put in a really large fence area to protect a pristine area of forest, and it's quite devastated now. So there seems to be, we get calls far more frequently in that area, and we know we found it in the soil there as well, in infected areas.
If you have along this land a dead tree or two amongst the growth, what do? You cut them down and burn them? Or?
Yeah, that's actually the best thing you can do. Yeah, and if you're going to keep them, you can keep them covered with a tarp. Also, dead and dying trees, attract insects, beetles, and so you can prevent them from kind of boring in and creating that grass. And then the sooner you can actually burn them for quite a while, the better.
Have you found any trees
that are still alive in stands and dead trees?
Yes.
And have you tested that for susceptibility?
Okay. I think some of it's a timing issue, that there has been cases where we sampled a healthy looking tree and we could actually internally find the fungus. So the process probably takes a couple years to actually cut off the water supply of the mature tree. Yeah. Again, it's more of the forestry plots and actually monitoring over time to see if things are going to survive. But just in the last year or two, or more than a quarter of the trees seem to die. So right now it doesn't look well for those monitoring plots. Yeah. But again, it's like early in this whole process. So still a lot to learn.
We live in an Ohio forest and I've been seeing it in the last few years, but the only other tree I've noticed exhibiting some is avocado. I had some rapid avocado death on the tree, and it's a lot fewer percentage-wise, I'd say, than Ohio, but it was just a lot of full-grown producing olive tree just died from the top down.
So that's not known to infect avocado here. Elsewhere in the world, it does cause a problem. But I'd be interested in connecting with you if you still have.
It could depend on the
Could.
It's hard to say.
Right. But if it is that similar, rapid, I mean, this organism causes very similar symptoms and lots of things.
These are like avocados interspersed with it.
Yeah, I like the microphone.
Okay. Is there any plan to do an aerial broadcast?
You mean to look at detection? Yeah, that's really the challenge on such a large scale native forest. Again, in other cases, say by nation forestry, they knew it was infected with pruning tools. So they would see, you know, from one and you just go down the road. They have a better understanding of when the organism is actually producing the most spores or other structures that. So it was easier to actually manage. So a lot of the diseases, they change management techniques or. You know, plant more resistant varieties, or this is a new challenge being the forest. So an overall treatment seems very difficult. I mean, unless natural farming. I mean, to me that makes more sense than maybe, I mean, a fungicide treatment in a native forest. No. It will be more of a case-by-case basis or a potential for stopping the advancing front. So.
Have you found a fungicide that will actually kill it?
Yes, we do have something we're working with. Unfortunately, you know, when it comes to the regulations, you have to follow label. And so it's not for label use, and currently it's not the way you can actually use it. So we're trying to work with the company to actually see what the potential is. But there is something that will actually kill it. Yeah.
Has there been research done on the interaction between other soil organisms around the opia trees and the fungus?
Not yet.
Did I see correctly on the last slide where it says in February 2016 the soil will be quarantined on island?
Yes, so that is still, we're still working to figure out, you know, what is the risk and with soil. Now, artificial potting medium or from certified nursery is, you know, other things like cinder, but it's soil from the ground we're trying to figure out, but HDOA, that's part of the list of vocabulary. So that's kind of a heads up.
I just wanted to make a comment. I saw an article with your name and a few other people, and I reached out to Lisa because I know that natural farmers have found solutions for many things that are plaguing the earth. And so I put a call out for us to, like, I've been looking at this, the plant slowly smothers, it doesn't, the water won't distribute through the tree. And so I brought lactic acid bacteria because we know as natural farmers that this helps the fertilizers move through the plants. And so some of us have brought some of our natural farming solutions for Lisa and her team to experiment with on this fungus. I also brought some imo tooth that we made. And there is also a natural farming brother, Chris DeMay in Michigan, who is using, Liz brought some of these with us for us to see. But he uses this mushroom. It's like a woody mushroom. And he has found success in making a solution with this that actually kills this. And so one of the things that I'd love for us to discuss here is, you know, this is just some of the natural farming things that have touched my heart because I'm from here. And I've been watching all these trees that I've known all my life die. And so we are going to be working together to find something that hopefully is more natural than a fungicide. Like Kim Chang has already said that she's healed a mountain apple tree that almost died. So has Chris Trump in Kohala. He has a macadamia nut farm there. And one of the things with the macadamia nut trees is if they get hurt or damaged, the whole tree dies. He has success in saving his trees that have gotten damaged from the machinery when they harvest. And so we know already that we have solutions that help the plants. And so tonight, I would love anyone that feels touched in their heart to be a part of this experiment team to come to me and give me your contact information. This is really important because our ohia is 50% of our watershed. We want to talk about the California droughts. Well, if this takes effect here, it's going to affect this whole island. Mm-hmm. It's going to affect us as natural farmers. Mm-hmm. And so I'm also, you know, when I think about the ohia, you know, we know how long it takes for an ohia to grow, okay? I'm glad that there's a seed bank happening. So quite a few of us have been gathering our IMOs from our healthy forests and preserving them because we know that once those forests die, those types of diversity in microorganisms also go. And so, and so if anybody feels moved, help. This affects all of us on like, such a deep level. And so please come to me. And we'd like to figure out ways to work with you and your team to figure out some natural farming solutions. I'd like to encourage some of your people that are with you to take the course next month, get a scholarship from your people, and learn a little bit more. Because as we know, this alone, lactic acid bacteria, this is a miracle, okay? We already know this. This brings no flies, no smells to our pig pens. This kills salmonella. This kills all the bad bacteria. Yeah, I use this on my counter instead of bleach, okay? And so I believe we have the solution, but it takes time and effort, and it takes people with heart that, you know, I know we're all busy just trying to survive, but I just wanted to reach out to any of you that want to be a part of this team to work with Lisa to find a way to heal our trees so that we can keep gathering them, so we can protect them, you know, so that we can protect not only our forest, but our culture. And so that's all I'm going to say. I know we went over our time.
Thank you for coming and sharing this with us.
So I took a few notes, and I just kind of wanted to build upon what Dana said, because I know you're here to kind of learn and to hear from us and to kind of hear. So, you know, I've been doing natural farming for about 8 years now or so. And we've done a lot of research, and we started out with kind of just rudimentary methods of figuring out like what works and what, how can we make things better. One of the things I really learned early on in natural farming is that the plating method, where you're culturing the bacteria on that plate, may or may not be effective for telling you that that's the pathogen that's there. In this case, it looks like that is the one, but as Michaela mentioned over here, that one of the things we're finding out is that in natural farming, is there's a new study coming out called metagenomics, which is really studying all of the microbes in the soil and how that when this condition happens, this one thrives and that one takes off, and how they're symbiotically all working with each other in there. And so that maybe this, I think that's the scientific name of the actual bacteria that's doing the final knockout punch to it. But it may be that the other microbes in the metagenomic area are having a fall, that then this pathogenic one then has an opportune time on your disease triangle, that it now has the host, like it's feeding off something else that now it can take over. So plating methods to actually tell which bacteria, like primarily we find just the parasitic and bad anaerobic growing ones growing plating methods. And the good microbes to culture them. What we do is we look at live soil samples under the microscope to see what's happening in the soils and see all how the other funguses are interacting with each other. And that's the main way we're telling our soil health. And so Dana mentioned Chris Trump. He's a macnut farmer up in Kohala. And he has 700 acres of macnuts. And they had several different fungal diseases hit them. They've had like rapid die-off, they've had slow die-off, they've had these different, he has identified at least three different types of fungal diseases that he's completely eliminated from his fields. And the way he's doing that is he's making a fungally dominated IMO solution. And so what it is it combines seawater, which has tons of minerals. And the more research I do on that, I find there's a microbe behind every mineral. So when you grab all these different minerals, you get this really microbial diversity you can bring back to the land. He's including in there humic and fulvic acids, which are essentially like wood juices, wood concentrates. And so these really stimulate fungus that loves to eat wood. You know, that's why it's attacking a tree here. And so when you include the humic and fulvic acids, which he gets primarily from wort juice, that then stimulates this beneficial fungus to thrive in this solution he's created. And then he's making really careful sure to make sure he grabs really good IMO collection from a very fungally dominated area already. So going to where he knows there's already a healthy forest and grabbing that IMO. And the fourth thing he's including in this batch is fermented plant juices, which essentially are plant concentrates. It's a recipe we're all familiar with here, but that is just making it into the mainstream in terms of its medicinal benefits, and also its plant, it contains plant secondary metabolites and all these very essential hormones and enzymes that other methods of extraction with heat or pressure or other ways kill. But in our method, with just extracting with pure sugar and allowing the microorganism to ferment at low temperature, extracts them in their very pure and same form. So it's essentially like taking the essence out of this plant without destroying it and putting it into this liquid. And if you look at what happens in a natural healthy forest, the leaves are falling, right? And that's what's feeding the forest, and that's what's keeping it healthy. And so this recipe of including the fermented plant juice, which essentially is concentrated leaves, then including humic and fulvic acids, which is concentrated tree branches that fall, then including the very good beneficial microorganisms you gather from a healthy part of the forest, and then combining it with seawater, which just enhances that diversity. And like I was saying, in natural farming, it's all about the metagenomics. the more diversity, just like look at this room, the more diversity we get, the more ideas we have coming, the more solutions we get coming forth. And so the seawater to really stimulate that extra diversity. With those tools, he basically makes a compost tea. And he, what he does is he takes his brewer, like a 500 gallon brewer, he brews his tea. He puts in, you know, not even that much into the, you know, he has it all measured out, the correct dilutions. He has the recipe. It's actually posted on the Facebook discussion that Dana and I were having. He puts all these things into the tea, and he brews it for 36 hours. And he found that's pretty much the sweet spot, because he's doing like microscope analysis. And he's looking for beneficial fungus, which are big, nice, dark brown fungus. But those are the beneficial ones. And at 36 hours, it's very highly fungal dominated. And then what he does is he loads it into a sprayer that one of his workers goes and then just sprays all his fields. So he stresses the highest precision quality of this. That that's why he brews the tea and loads it into the sprayer for then his workers to go out. Because before he's asked his workers to make the tea, and it's that level of precision that they sometimes, you know, like, oh, you didn't put this much, or you brewed it for maybe 72 hours, or you know, whatever happened, then you are spraying more pathogens out. But when you do this right and correctly, he's able to completely bring trees back to life from the core out. He said sometimes trees will regrow, like with certain techniques, they'll put a little bit more foliage on the outside, but he's actually seeing new shoots emerge from the inside out on these so what some call dead trees. Like the tree looks dead, not like it, you know, someone would come and just cut it down because the thing was dead. He sprays this solution and the tree still comes back to life. And so it's an association that as we study more science, we find that there's fungus not only in our soil, but also in the plants themselves, in everything. It turns out to be the most vital part of our ecosystem. Is this beneficial fungus, which we call in here IMO, which is just, it's just a diversity. It just means it's from here and it's the microbes that are the beneficial ones in our forest. And the other thing that I heard previously, I don't know if this was the case, but that it was spreading more on the roadsides. And that may be from vehicles, but also the roadsides, are constantly, as your exhaust comes out, all these toxins are coming out and just landing. You know, like try to breathe car exhaust for a couple minutes, you could probably die, right? And so this same stuff is being blown out onto the road. So all that beneficial fungus that was in the environment now has a layer of hydrocarbons and toxins on top of it. So as we continue to pollute our environment by driving cars, we're putting more of this toxin out. So the beneficial fungus that was there, it's very essential that it's aerobic. And if it's covered with this layer of oil on top, it cannot breathe anymore. So it starts to die, and then probably this one is anaerobic, I bet. Grows it up, or maybe not. Okay, so maybe that's through extrapolation on that, but maybe the metagenomics is changing in the soil so that it's, you know, it's stressed. Like if you have a beneficial thing with plenty of food, plenty of people come, no food, no people come. Same with the fungus in the soil. So putting the foods out there. And the other comment I just wanted to make as natural farmers, we always make the analogy of like using a fungicide or like an herbicide is kind of like taking your skin and ripping it off. Yeah, sure, I got clean, sterile environment, but as soon as something lands on me, I now immediately got infection. So if I use a fungicide, yeah, I can get rid of it, but I've now stripped all those beneficial guys as well. It's like you got a criminal in Hilo and you use a nuclear bomb to get them. Yeah, you got them, but you caused a lot of collateral damage as well. And so fungicide, we tend to go away from that, and instead of just using one bomb to blow it up, we just bring in beneficial people to like hold space to do good things. And so we take a probiotic approach, and that's what all about the IMOs is about, is just bringing so much diversity, so many good things into the soil that there's no room for bad guys. You know, if there's a bad guy in here, we throw him out, right? But if we set off a bomb and a bad guy came, who's gonna throw him out? So we like to use just simple analogies along those lines to just start our thinking towards just putting good guys out there and really trying to see how can we get the good guys? What do they need? What do the good guys need from us? to naturally combat things like this. Because in a healthy forest, you don't see stuff like this happening. But as we toxify our world more and more, you start to see all kinds of plagues like this just popping up. And so our whole approach in natural farming is just restore, regenerate, rejuvenate, get foods out there, get good guys out there, and let them take care of it for us. So that's my mana on that. Any other questions on that or any?
Okay, as far as the seawater, what's most preferable, like Conoco's or like Lady E.B. Richardson, which is heavily diluted, yeah? What would be preferable?
I don't have any quantifiable data on that, of where to grab some seawater from. I know, you know, Hawaiian Island leaks a lot of water, so no matter where you gather near the coast, you're gonna get a fair amount of dilution. I don't know. One way to be sure is to get sea salt and then dilute that. And I don't have the exact dilution on me, but you can just grab sea salt and make your own seawater that way. Oh, and then I brought a little package of IMO. I spilled a bunch of oil in my car oil, and I put the IMO down on top of the car oil, and it cleaned it all up, and then I put it in this package so you can analyze it. No, but I'm gonna talk about the stuff that we learned in Korea, and it's very exciting. The stuff like cockroaches and insects, we got a lot of good news on that. So let's take some time and grind some food and enjoy each other's company. Who has the time? I don't.
7:14.
Okay, so let's take maybe the next 15 minutes to grab food, grind, and then I'll take the last half hour to kind of talk about what I learned in Korea and stuff like that. So how's the food? But I talked about the food here. We had great food here. Why? Natural farmers, right? So the entire time we were in Korea, oh, God.
The food.
This trip, if it ever comes up again, it's worth going strictly for the food. Seriously. Just tables loaded with food, everything, all kinds of stuff, kimchi with every meal. Koreans are real smart. They ferment. They eat a fermented thing with every dish. So you eat food, but then you eat this fermented food to help you digest. All indigenous cultures around the world, you'll find eat fermented food with almost every meal. They were very aware of the microorganisms. So we went back to Korea. I was there in 2008. We went back just recently. We went back, it was October, beginning of October we went.
November.
Excuse me, November, yeah, thank you. I've been on time travel since then. But who went with us? It was Don Mende, our vice mayor from Hawai'i County. Clarice.
Ninokawa,
mahalo. Fresh Onishi, our county council representative. David Fuertes and Dr. Park were part of a county entourage that went with us. They were there to accomplish a lot of different things. But included along that trip was Mike DuPont, legendary Mike DuPont. Right? Zach Mermel. That's why he knows Clarice's last name. Chris Trump, the guy I talked about that's been researching this fungal cure for his macnut orchards. Kim Chang, expert natural farmer. She already went to Hula. And myself. and I don't know if I've met anybody else. But this party was all people who are kind of privy to natural farming and or very important to our county governance. And so we had several objectives while we were there of what we were doing. So I'm going to kind of give you a list of like what we did and explain each of them kind of briefly as I go through it. I got about probably 10 more minutes to talk, just so that we are all get to go home and tend to our farms, even though it's makahiki. But one of the first things we did was we got into Seoul, and then the next morning we rode a train down to Gokseong County. So Gokseong, we've been working with them since 2005 or 2008, I'm not exactly sure when, but a while, to establish a sister city relationship. So Hilo and Gokseong County are now sister cities. And so that's kind of like official government language that means that now we have this relationship where essentially what they want to do is have their students come to our county to learn, to just like see what is out there. You know, when you're a young kid and you travel around the world and you see different cultures, and Hawaii is such a melting pot of all cultures, that they want to expose their kids to that. And also get them kind of educated on the Hawaiian language, even though I'm not sure they know we speak pidgin here. But that's okay. The thing we were really interested in is the farmer exchange. So their farmers there, Gokseong County is one of the more prominent natural farming counties in all of Korea. They've been doing it for several years. It started with a mafia boss who went and took Master Cho's seminar and then opened his heart up. And then because he was a mafia boss, he had some power, so he told the government, hey, you guys do this. Yeah. And so they did. And they've continued to do it for a long time now. And so one of the first things we went there is we saw their world-class learning center. We walked into this facility and it had all these rice things in, formaldehyde, I think it was. And it showed all the different growth and how farmers, when they applied the microorganisms and they applied this natural farming, how it affected their rice. So you can see how many more grain kernels there were on top. You can also see the health of the stalk, thicker stalks. You can also see the nice roots down below. And you can tell certain farmers that had better natural farming practices than others by these roots and how the rice plants look. They also had their just all kinds of informational set, like a little video you watched, and then just the whole thing that showed all the tools that natural farmers use. So we know all those things, IMO, FPJ, all those acronyms, right? And they would show them and explain them to you and really go through the process with you there. They also had an IMO machine. Another function of this learning facility is it enabled people to collectively make inputs together, store them there, go and learn and make it with an expert. So like I said, Chris Trump, it's all about precision, right? So when you make it with the experts at this learning facility, you know you're making it correctly. After that learning facility, we went on some farm tours to see it actually in production, commercial, viable operations. We saw a strawberry farm, which they were using IMO in a fertigation type system to use. And they also use some, I think they use some foliar stuff once in a while, but the majority of it was through a fertigation tank. So they would take well watered up, mix their natural farming inputs in, and then run it down their strawberry line. There were no strawberries to be seen, but their plants looked so healthy, just so robust, so vital. Then we went and we ate lunch with this rice place where this guy is developing rice based on health. So instead, not the highest yield, not this or that, but he's based on which is the healthiest rice for humans to consume. So using natural farming, the most environmentally friendly practices, he then also is now putting which varieties work the best. It was delicious. He gave us a sample. I brought it to the farmers union meeting the other day, so some people in here probably ate it. Then we saw a sesame leaf farm. Which is, I don't know if anyone's familiar with sesame leaf, but basically it's a big leaf that kind of reminds me of giant oregano, but softer than that, and it doesn't taste like oregano. It tastes, I don't know.
They called it perilla, P-E-R-I-L-L-A.
Yeah, perilla. Yeah, okay, so you know it by a different name. Okay. So they're growing this, and the guy gave us a sample of this stuff, in this bag, and usually the thing wilts after like 2 days or something. I took it, I put it in my suitcase and just forgot about it, you know, because I was like, what am I gonna, you know, I just put it in there. When I was packing my stuff to leave on the eighth day, we saw this on maybe the second day, the eighth day later, so 6 days later, the stuff still looked as if it was just freshly picked. There's so much vitality and life in this thing that he didn't have to worry about shelf life and preservation. It was just so abundant. That was cool. He was also growing greens, like lettuce greens with natural farming. Then from there, we went on and we saw a quail farm where they raised 450,000 quails. I think that was the number. And they got 2 tons of quail eggs, what, like a week or something? And so this place was producing, they were selling primarily to schools and prisons, I think, and like to state-run facilities, but they supply all the quail eggs for everyone to eat. They're also the hatchery for 80% of the country. And they had like a 99% survival rate, or even higher than that survival rate, because they were feeding their quails this IMO4 mix into their food. So they had next to no disease and no fatalities, which is really common in poultry-type industries. When you're raising birds, you know, bird flu comes through. These guys have never been affected by bird flu, ever. In the back, the guy was experimenting with ginseng planting. We had this shade house, and he used the IMO, and he was planning on growing ginseng for 15 years, which is unheard of, because usually after 7 years, there's so much bacteria and whatever, it dies. So, but with the IMO, he's planning on growing it for 15 years, and he said one root would sell for $150,000. So he's really thinking that's like his cash cow, that's his investment, that's how he's really capitalizing on natural farming to be his, you know, to pay off for him. The quails just kept, you know, keep him alive, right? Then we went on to go see a chicken farm, which was kind of a small-scale chicken farm. It was maybe from the wall to me. Here, and within that there was 4 pens, each with 120 chickens, or yeah, 130 chickens each in these pens from here to there. So you think of that, this small space from the wall to me here, 130 chickens. That seems like pretty high density, right? These chickens were smiling from ear to ear. They were so happy. There was not even a roof on top of the chicken pen. The fence came up this high, and the chickens didn't even want to get out and escape. They were so happy in the pen, because they had, for every 10 hens, they had a rooster. They had the rack lined up so they could get their pecking order in line. They had the great food for them, so they were all content. They had supplements. When I went to go take the egg to crack the egg, raw egg, to go, and I ate the raw egg, it was a really intense experience. I thought I was going to dent the wooden table with the egg. The eggshell was so hard and firm because they were using these certain additives, which I have a video about if you want more details. That was really cool. I almost puked in front of everyone when I ate the raw egg. Mostly because my head was like, oh, it's gross, but it tasted really delicious. Then we went on to see a pig farm, and this one guy was raising 800 pigs by himself. And he had this fully automated system. We went there, there was absolutely no smell. It was a beautiful operation that he had. Although when we went there, the pigs, they were kind of scared of you. When you walked up, they kind of ran to the back. And later when we got onto the bus, after seeing this full operation, he said, Master Cho said, hey, this wasn't really a true pig farm. This guy had too big of a scale. One man trying to do 800 pigs, he couldn't love each pig enough. So they were kind of scared and they would run to the back, and he had all these automated systems. And Master Cho asked him, how much money do you make? And he said, oh, just enough to eat. And so he had invested so much in equipment and that kind of stuff to make it easier for one man to do that, that now he owed, you know, the machine is going to break, right? And then you got to owe more money into it. And so when you invest that way and you scale up too much, you can't go, you know, away from natural farming. So it's really eye-opening for me to see something where it's like everyone always wants to scale up. How big can this go? But how big is your heart is the real answer. Or question. Master Cho recommends 10 sows in instead of he had 80 sows, 80 breeding sows, instead of 80, 10 is what Master Chorik owned, with 400 chickens like we saw, and then 2 cows. But in Korea, they do the cows indoors, so it's a bit different. But that's his recommended farm size, and that way that you get systems that work. You don't overstress yourself trying to feed them. It all works.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me, sir. What are sows?
Sows are female breeding pigs. So then we kind of enter and out of the country, which Korea is mountainous, and the entire countryside is a rice field. And where it isn't a rice field, it's a greenhouse. And where it isn't a greenhouse, it's a cabbage patch. And literally the entire country was planted, and it was kind of astounding to me that as we went up into the mountains, I had been there previously, and the agriculture was in all the lowlands, but now on this trip, as we went up into the mountains, the agriculture was going up into the mountains. And they say that's the sign you're in the last few decades of your civilization, as you start to go into your mountains, just because of how everything's going. Other interesting fact is that Korea, they farm, and 30% of their food stays domestic, and they feed almost their entire nation domestically, and they export 70% of their food. So when we went there was infrastructure everywhere. You're on a bridge, and you're looking at a Honolulu rail next to another Honolulu rail next to another one, and there's so much infrastructure and bridges and everything everywhere, and they're so rich because of the agriculture, because that's free money that comes out of the air and soil, right? Not to generate any, you know, it's just free money. So Korea was extremely rich. I didn't see the oldest, I saw one car that was more than 10 years old. All the rest looked like they were manufactured in the last 3 to 4 years. So it was a trip to see that. And as we headed more into the city, we started to see the sprawl, just construction crews building skyscrapers next to skyscrapers, next to water parks, next to, like, we dropped Master Cho off on the side of the road, and he just kind of, like, walked away. but then we headed into the city. We went to Tajong, and we met up with Dr. Lee, who's going to visit with Cho Young Song, Master Cho's son. He's going to come November 28th. He's going to give a lecture. And he talked about, he's an analytical chemist, so he's studying the nutritional value of natural farming. So what's the difference between using this and that to then grow your end product? And the end product is what matters, right? The apple that you're eating, how nutritious is that apple? You have to eat 10 of them to get the same nutrition from one of them. And this is the type of research he's doing to uncover for us and to help us. And it turns out that it's actually really the sweet spot is in the plant secondary metabolites, which is something I spoke about earlier. That these things like the good fragrance of a great apple, that is a plant secondary metabolite. It's a very complex chemical structure that other types of farming, just you smell it and it smells like cardboard. But when you do natural farming, it has this great fragrance to it. And it's these very complex structures that create that for us. And that is what ultimately is help and ultimately helps the microbes to thrive. We also then went to visit Young Song Cho, who's Master Cho's son. And he's been doing extremely innovative research. He works with really, really poor people. He's trying to target Africa, and not to say Africans poor, like that's crazy because they have all the resources. But for, you know, as things are, helping them get their agricultural foothold again with just a machete. And so he taught us how to make IMO in an ultra low cost method, just using water, potato, leaves from the forest, and sea salt. That's it, in a bucket. And you get the same as doing the IMO. So this is an extremely low cost method to do, to coat, just spray from sprayers all over our forest to bring all this biology back, to put all these good guys back, to put trillions of good guys there. So when the bad guys come, they're like, yeah. So this is huge for us. The second thing he unveiled to us is the thing that is formerly known as a pesticide, calling it a natural bug solution. He takes sulfur and sodium hydroxide and salt, lava rock, and red dirt and water, combines it, heats up to about 400 degrees. That solubilizes the sulfur and becomes, formerly known as pesticide. that then targets all kinds of pathogenic fungi and stuff. I'll take questions after.
It's not a question, it's a comment.
Yo.
About natural for pesticides, you can use orange or lime dish soap with no additives, and mix with water and spray on the plants with them organic pesticide free for plants and plant up. We've tried that and it worked quite well.
So there's lots of ways, but this way, essentially we used to use calcium and sulfur before World War II, before they unleashed the bombs on the earth, fertilizer, sorry. and so this is the ancient way of doing it, and it's super effective. There, things don't build up resistance to it, and sulfur is amazing, and if you spray it in your mouth, which I do, you're fine. You can swallow it. Then he unveiled to us an insecticide, and he made some very large promises to us. In fact, I don't think I can call it that either. The thing formerly known as insecticide, which essentially it's canola oil and potassium hydroxide that you combine, and that creates a thicker spreader. And then he takes plants such as Jerusalem artichoke, or Glyrosidia, or Lantana, or something that no bug ever eats. You take it, you boil it down in a pressure cooker, you mix that concentrate into this canola oil and sodium hydroxide, potassium, I'm not sure exactly which one. But you mix that in, then you spray it. It's again, who's ever died from eating Jerusalem artichoke? Nobody, right? But the bugs die when they eat it. So you can spray this out, you're completely immune to it. All the beneficial things in the ecosystem are completely immune to it. But we can wipe out fire ants, can wipe out slugs, can wipe out mosquitoes. Coffee borer bug, he talked about taking out. And he's researching for us which plants will do that for us. But it's really simple recipe. It costs less than $100 per acre per year to do. Got three more things on here, which is we went to see this hospital where they're healing people. Instead of pumping you full of chemotherapy and poisons, they're pumping you full of good food and studying the epigenetics and studying how love can actually help you to heal. And so it's this innovative recipe where they're just helping people, all kinds of people being cured. The guy who started that started a company called Erom, E-R-O-M. This company makes really high quality foods for export. They have a distributor here in Hawaii, but that's a way that you can get just super kind nutritional supplements. That he studied all this stuff and he's trying to integrate natural farming into it, and that's why we're invited. He's actually, his wife is Dr. Park's neighbor, which is why we got treated like royalty when we went there. After that, we went to Kong Kok University, which is the way I understand it, it's like the Yale of agricultural colleges in Korea. It's like the top agriculture college in Korea. And we met with the dean of the agricultural department, and each of our party was paired with a graduate student. The guy sitting next to me was a professor in Afghanistan who was getting a PhD in natural farming so he could bring it back to Kabul, I think. And then the other dude, when I walked in, he's from Uganda, and he's like, hey, I know you, from YouTube. He was stoked. So we got to see all of their research that they've done. And they're kind of in the beginning stages of where, you know, they're starting to research master chose methods, but they haven't quite refined what we have in Hawaii, where we understand the effect of the fungus. And so with that targeting, how we've enhanced and really brought these recipes to just like a super scientific precision, which is essential when you're getting a PhD. You want to do it correctly. You know, you don't want to just study just any kind of stuff. Like, you know, if it came in a bag that was sealed with air, now you've killed your fungus because you cut it off from oxygen. So there's a high precision to this, and studying it and doing and understanding the metagenomics and what is actually happening in soil, they're just starting to get into that. So if you want to get a PhD, go enroll in Kong Kok. And they're going to be traveling. Dr. Kim's going to be traveling with Master Cho to this island. And he'll give a talk at the seminar talking about how they're going to integrate those programs in.
A degree in what?
Natural farming. So the next day, we got to tour Seoul. But we spent most of the day, the Kungkuk guys were so impressed with what happened the night before, where we presented to them what we were doing, that they just hung out with Chris Trout, myself, and everybody, and they basically just, we downloaded them with everything we had. They just were like, okay, what about this, what about this, what about this, and we're like, okay. And I recorded most of that conversation. It's on YouTube. It's one of the more better things that I've done. It's not actually teaching a class. It's just a guy finding out from another guy. And so he's telling just real personal stories and how things work. So that's online. You'll see it. We're in a museum walking around. And I'm not checking. It's this beautiful museum with all this stuff. And I really don't even care. I'm just talking about natural farming. But there was a cool samurai that I got a picture with.
Can I
share
another comment about the art
show? Hang on a sec. I'll take it after. Okay. So then we got to go to the spa. I highly recommend you go to the spa over there. And that's about it I have for Korea on this. So I'll take your comment now.
About artichokes being one of the easiest to grow things, they may be one of the easier things to grow. So are sweet potatoes and pumpkins, but they all seem to desolate the land. You really need to have a balance in the order of things that you can plant to see that they work off each other and stuff like that, and that they're available and climatic to your area and profitable for what you're trying to serve. Because a lot of the things defile the land, especially if not properly, you really do need to have a balance in your garden or your farm or production, whatever it is you guys are seeking to do. Balancing the bases with the acids and the fruits with the vegetables and not having too much interference and stuff like that, not getting too many people involved and keeping it. Okay, that's all I
have to
say. Thanks.
Okay, so mahalo for that. And that leads me to the next part that I was going to mention here is that we just screened In Search of Balance at the Palace Theater. About 100 people came to watch the video. Every single person left stoked. This movie is about natural farming. It's filmed here on the Big Island. Features Ginger John, Mike DuPont, me. And we go into the science of this, and it's called In Search of Balance. It's going to be screened at the Honoka'a's People's Theater coming up, and I believe it's going to be on the 18th, it's going to be a Thursday, so the Thursday nearest to the 18th of December. Check it out, because I don't know your exact date right now. 17th. Okay, boom, it's going to be the 17th of December, Honoka'a's People's Theater, I think at 7 p.m. We'll probably screen it again at the Palace pretty soon. It is already going out to film festivals, they're previewing these things. It's already won several awards. The movie won't be released until March or April, but since I'm in the movie and I talked to the production person, they're gonna send me 50 copies of the DVD. So if you're interested and you want a copy, please send me an email. My email is drakew@gmail.com. And I can get you a copy. Great Christmas gift. It's going to be between $10 and $15, depending. And great movie to give out, because it's natural farming, right? And the last little bit of that is that if you took down my email and you're not on the email list, email me and say, add me to the list, because I will. Because we're looking for a venue for our meeting for January, which this room will not be scheduled for January, and Omahana is now under construction again. So January, we're looking for a venue to hold this meeting, but we will be meeting here for the rest of next year, 2023.
There's here at 17th.
Okay, so.
I'll give you the schedule.
Okay, so it's gonna be between here and Auntie Sally's, right?
Yeah.
7 Seas Llewellyn House,
yeah.
Right by the tennis stadium. So we're gonna be balancing between here and there to make sure that we have this meeting continuous. It's been going for at least 6 years now, I don't know. It's December, so we gotta celebrate a whole nother year of keeping this thing going. Thank you all for showing up, and any questions?
Yeah, I have a question.
I just have an announcement.
Yeah.
I just, Steve Lund wanted to make an announcement, and so.
I can make an announcement.
I'm introducing an announcement. Steve Lund is the founder of Hawaiian Sanctuary, and and so he.
We do educational classes in Pune on Thursdays, a planting classes. I've been doing it for 8 years. I haven't missed one Thursday yet. But we've been doing a lot of permaculture. We've been doing all types of agroforestry, different stuff like that. But my latest passion, of course, is natural farming. So, because I'm not an expert, I've asked Drake, I've asked Dana to come and teach a class. And so if there's any people here that consider themselves sort of a teacher of that subject, it pays like $20 an hour for 3.5 hours, Thursday from 9 to 12:30, and we include lunch from our land. So we actually like eat the food that we plant. It's really cool. And we end up making a lot of people help them out with planting and help them with their gardens, help them with their forest, their building, whatever it is. Anyways, if anybody has an interest in teaching a class like that, you can reach me after tonight.
Where's the location,
Michelle?
Hawai'i Sanctuary,
12
mile marker, right after
Pahoa. Yeah, right at Pahoa, basically, yeah.
Kalapana Site or Pahoa?
Just right at Pahoa, yeah.
And the one last thing I wanted to add to along the trip to Seoul, we stayed in Gangnam. Yeah, it was a lot of fun. And I got this shirt for like really a good deal. I got this for a really good deal. And I really recommend you check out Korea. It's pretty awesome.